Institute in Germany, and he had never thrown a punch. He was scared, trembling when he before he got in the ring. Okay, and he had never been disciplined as a kid. He'd never been screamed at as a kid. He was a goody little two shoes, PhD.
He was in his suit when he threw the punch, right?
No, he wasn't.
He really did. Some of the guys
were. Some of the guys, because they weren't going to fight, and then they got involved in the moment. They had brought the right shit, so then they got involved in the moment because the guys enjoy it. But one of the reasons we came up with the boxing is because before we started the boxing, we had four fights and three seminars of the guys duking it out. I go to sleep. They never fight when I'm awake. I go to sleep. We say Saturday night, say goodnight. And then in the morning, we wind up, we've only had a couple pieces of furniture broken. And the guys bellied up. They paid for it.
In the castle, they're fighting, throwing punches at
them. Correct.
Okay.
That's correct. And about a year ago, we had a little Arab guy, a little teeny mouse who had been pushed around by a bigger guy. The graduation night, he cold cocked him. As he was walking through the main hall.
Okay, but that's all your fault, right? Because you're alpha, everybody.
Oh, yeah, and the adrenaline is pumping. I mean, some of the guys didn't even know what an adrenaline rush was.
Okay, so this is a positive thing.
Yeah.
So look, I remember when I was up at the castle, I said they don't make them like Dan Pena anymore, and we should cherish for what he tells us. You're kind of giving us a glimpse into what we were in the past. And you're trying to remind us that there were good things there.
Yeah.
What do you say against all the people that say, well, violence isn't the solution, and we should embrace the feminine side, and all of that stuff?
Okay, I'll say if love worked, there would be no personal development. Love doesn't get the job done. Okay, love doesn't work. Religion doesn't work. Nothing works other than if you have self-esteem as a human being. You're a better person, you're a better father, you're a better husband, better wife, whatever the hell, you're a better citizen. You take life more serious if you have self-esteem, if you have self-worth. I said it the other night. Gallup poll did 2016-17 a study. 86.6% of the people on the planet, of the 7 billion, are unhappy. They've locked out. They're not looking for anything in life. And I say, I'd like to find the 13%. Because most people are living hand to mouth. Most people are living paycheck to paycheck. Okay? That's why your programs are so successful. Because you give them alternatives. Okay? That's why Dan Loeb's programs are so successful. Because he gives them alternatives. And the alternatives aren't being taught. When I was at these various universities that I've had the privilege of speaking at, one of the first questions I ask is, how many classes have you had buying a business? How many classes have you been had selling a business? No hands go up. How many classes have you had? This is the business schools.
Right.
How many classes have you had in leadership? None. Except for Naval Academy more recently. None. Well, then how in the fuck? What are they teaching you here? If you don't know how to buy a business, sell a business, and you can't lead the people, but they're not being taught, there's
that. You're trying to change all that.
Correct.
Okay. And what about the women that come? Are you not teaching them try to be men? Because
No. But we had the last seminar. We had two women get in the ring, and one of the women wanted to get in the ring with a guy, and I wouldn't allow that. I didn't know what the outcome was. But the women. I mean, they were throwing punches. Not like, you used to see, scratching
guys. They were duking it out.
Yeah, they were pretty good.
So this isn't a social experiment, but looked at it from a social lens. You're trying to get people to kind of man up.
Correct.
Get the self-esteem back by any means necessary and start pulling the trigger.
As long as it's legal, moral, and ethical.
Okay.
Right. And what the kids have said, I tell them all, go where there's a rule of law. If there's no rule of law, truly can't work. Right? Not can. Much more difficult. There's no rule of law. But morality and ethics swing in the wind because everybody's morals and ethics are different. And the ethics and morality in Russia is different than in Connecticut. Okay? That they have to, kind of feel the way through. But what was socially acceptable in the early 80s when I got started, actually the late 70s when I got started, isn't socially acceptable now. And they have bad names for people that go around and do some of the stuff that they used to do. So you have to be aware.
And so
absolutely. And that's what the Dream Team does. The Dream Team, because it's experience, you've got 100 to 150 years of experience. The Dream Team is there to tell you what you can do. And they can also tell you how to, you're still going to make mistakes, but not to make the most obvious mistakes.
Okay. And look, today I want to get into a few more details of QLA. I want to talk about the Dream Team, and I want to do a couple of mini case studies with Josh Kim, Klaus Liefeld, and maybe even go into Rick Scott, former senator, former governor, now senator.
Correct.
Potential
president.
President of the United States in 2024. We'll get into that as well.
Okay.
Back, just to finish out our loop on IQs, you're talking about me as an engineer, saying the smarter you are, the less risk, the more risk averse you are.
Give me a case study.
Yeah, give me a case study.
Okay, the guy with a closer to 80 IQ was responsible for a $400 million deal, healthcare in this country. Okay, he was a joiner, carpenter, right? Okay, he had one O level. For those of you in Britain, you know what that means. He had a D in joinery. Okay, 180 IQ. Let's go up about, 80, 100 points. The guy is on the Hall of Fame. And he's doing, with his 180 IQ, he went to university 4 days. He did four finals each year. He never went to class. Graduated top of his class, and also computer science engineering. Okay. And he's doing 10, 20 million euro deals. And he's never even come close to a $400 million deal. Because the computer scientist, you talk about fucking analyzing it. I mean, he's waiting for on the 29th of February, all the moon and everything to be juxtaposed. And so he doesn't pull the trigger. Whereas the carpenter, he just jumped on it like like stink on shit. And just, was persevering, just kept driving, and until the deal got done.
So QLA works better with people that don't overthink it.
Correct.
And you said, I remember you said this to me, you said it takes the longest time for engineers to get it. But
correct.
Once they get it, they implement it more effectively than other people.
Correct.
And why is that?
Because there are advantages to the skill sets of the engineer. It's no accident that 40% of all the billionaires are engineers. That's not an accident. Okay, and once they get it, and once that penny drops or the shoe drops, whatever the saying you want to use, then they just, the world is their oyster.
Yeah, what you taught me to do is to engineer risk into my life.
Correct.
So now every time I'm faced with a decision, or sometimes even when I'm not faced with a decision, I just think, how can I engineer more risk in this situation? Whereas before, I would try my hardest to engineer less risk in the situation, which meant slow, and I played it safe, and at the end of the day, it didn't matter anyways. What's a couple people know that you
know? Yeah, so you play Santa Clara in the way, and you play that blues. Now, one of the other concepts we're talking about, I don't know if you were there a few years ago, but we heard that you just heard your song, and so we started playing it as live, but it moves a little arms around. And I'm not sure how I explain when you started. From the people, so we started this mostly as a
more net worth.
Oh, absolutely. In fact, I looked at it before I drove over here. 51% of my demographics comes from 15 to 34. About 50%. Okay. 15 to 34. And even though the 15 to 25 is only 20%, they exist, what, 10 years ago they didn't. And the 40% is from 25 to 34. So, as I said at the end of my demographics, have gone upside down. And it's because the young kids, don't want to make the same mistakes as their parents. And as I told you, when I asked the audiences, and I asked the Hyperloop guys, how many of you would want your kids to be like you? One guy said, well, parts of me. I don't mean parts of you.